In one of the previous videos, I talked about this multi-level cell or MLC technology, and I described to you how cool a technology it was. It essentially allowed me to store twice or thrice or sometimes even four times the amount of data in the same cell. So it was clearly a technology meant for tough economic times or, you know, times of recession. But what I want to do in this video is to talk a little bit about what is the trade-off. What is the trade-off if I store two or three or four bits per cell? So how does the performance change as compared to, you know, storing a single level in the cell? And to do that, I need to introduce two new terms in your vocabulary. One is called as endurance, or also called as cycling, and the other term I want to introduce is stress induced leakage current, also called as silk. So let's look at what these terms mean first. So the first term I want to introduce is called as endurance, or it's also sometimes called as cycling. And cycling here, you know, has little relationship with what Lance Armstrong used to do. But what cycling a cell or endurance of a cell is means is that each time you program or erase the cell, each of that operation is called a cycling operation. And typically for these single level cells, you have up to 10 to power 5. They are meant to, you know, last up to 10 to power 5 cycles, or you can program or erase them 10 to power 5 times. So what do I mean by this endurance or these cycling? So what happens when you program or erase these cells is you essentially inject electrons into your cell when you want to program it, and you inject these electrons out of the cell when you want to erase it. So you are flowing these electrons in and out using, you know, by doing this program erase operation in the cell. And what happens is that it degrades the quality of this tunnel oxide. So remember, these tunnel oxide as well as these interpoly dielectric or IPD oxide, these are insulator materials. They are silicon oxide or, you know, similar dielectric materials. And what we are doing here is we are essentially flowing current in and out of these tunnel oxide. So we are treating them as conductors when they are really insulators. So these materials don't tend to like that. And what happens is that over a period of time, when you keep on programming and erasing the cell, when you are essentially flowing electrons in and you are flowing electrons out, some of these electrons get trapped in this tunnel oxide. And what that does is that it changes your program erase window. So now you have some electrons already trapped in your tunnel oxide. So your VT or your threshold voltage of your erase state is essentially goes up, because there's already some amount of trapped charge stored in your cell. At the same time, these electrons, they prevent these electrons which are trapped in your oxide, they prevent other electrons from flowing into your floating gate. So you are able to store less number of electrons in your program state. So your program VT degrades. So your program VT essentially degrades, or it decreases, and your erase VT increases. So in turn, what happens is your program erase window, which is determined by this difference between my program and erase state, that window starts to close, or this window is essentially it's decreasing. And so these cells are built such that they can survive this program erase cycling to up to 10 to power 5 cycles, or they are meant to endure this program erase operation to up to 10 to power 5 times. The other term, or, you know, the other phenomena which happens when you program and erase these cells is there is a stress-induced leakage current, which starts to happen, or it's also known as SILC, standing for stress-induced leakage current. So what it means is that when I keep on programming and erasing my cells, I'm stressing these tunnel oxide materials, because, you know, they are not really meant to be conductors, and when you are flowing electrons in and out, you are essentially stressing them, and They don't like it. So what happens is that these trap states develop in my dielectric. So it creates these trap states in my insulator material. And it's, you know, it's not as bad as this is only one of these trap states, but these trap states, when they line up in this manner as shown over here, so they can what they can do is they can allow tunneling of electrons through these trap states. So these trap states can assist the tunneling of electrons from my silicon into my floating gate, also from my floating gate back to my silicon. And this especially plays a lot of havoc at low voltage states, because ideally, if I was in a I w if I was applying a low voltage between my silicon and my floating gate, I would expect little or no tunneling. But because of these trap states, which build up due to cycling of my device and the stress which comes with my cycling, instead of getting zero current, so I now get a substantial current at these low voltages across my dielectric. And this phenomenon is known as stress-induced leakage current. So this was the ideal case where, you know, from theoretical, from our Faller-Nordem or direct tunneling model, you would expect, you know, negligible current, less than a picoamp of current, but because of these stress-induced leakage or these trap state, you get this high amount of, or you get this tunneling current. And this tends to again also degrade the performance of your cells. So suppose you had a retention requirement of 10 years, and you had a lot of these trap state created during programming and erasing your cell, your charge can now leak out, you know, in less than a year. So now that we know about endurance and silk, let's look at what happens to the distribution of our threshold voltages as we cycle our cells. So in one of the previous videos, I talked, you know, that our threshold voltage, it has this Gaussian kind of a distribution for each of this state. So this is my state 0, this is maybe my state 1, 2, and 3. So it has, when I initially program the cell, it has this tight distribution around a narrow set of threshold voltages. But what happens as I cycle my cell, so let's say this was my state, you know, at my very first time I program or erase the cell. So when I cycle the cell after, let's say, 1,000 cycles, this distribution becomes more wider. So it becomes maybe, let's say, after 1,000 number of cycle, it becomes something like this, where I have a larger range of my threshold voltages, because as I talked about, you know, I'll be building up some charge. So it will degrade my erase VT and increase, you know, increase my erase VT and degrade my program VT. So as a result, on a statistically speaking, I'll get a larger threshold voltage distribution. And as I keep on going even further, maybe, you know, I'll get an even larger distribution when I'm programming at 100k times or 10 to power 5 times. So over, as I keep on cycling my cell, this distribution of threshold voltages for one particular state, it keeps on increasing. And this have been fine if I had, you know, just two states and I had very large separation between these states. But as you can see, if I have four of these states, when I you know, keep on cycling them, each of these states will, you know, expand in its distribution. And if these distribution starts you know, coinciding with each other, then I have a problem. And if this was a problem, if you think this was a problem in 2 bits per cell, let's look at, you know, if I had 3 bits per cell. So if I was storing 3 of these bits, so I'll be having 2 to power 3 of these, or 8 of these states. And now each of these state, as I keep on cycling them, they will essentially, each of them will have, you know, this is at the very first time I program or erase them, and then this is maybe after 1000 times, and this is after 10 to power 5 times. So you know, you can clearly see that if I program 3 bits per cell or a TLC cell for 10 to power 5 times, I'll be getting these overlapping region, which I don't know which state my cell in, whether it's in state 3 or whether it's in state 4. So one of the major limitations you get when you store multiple levels in one single cell is that you can only program and erase them for, let's say, 10 to power 4 or 10k cycles or 10 to power 3 times or 1k cycles. And this is summarized in this table over here. So as you can see, if I had a single level cell at a 50 nanometer technology or even at a 30 nanometer technology, I could cycle it 10 to power 5 or 100k times, and I could still distinguish between these two my program and erase states, which had a very large separation between them. But now it's, let's say I have a MLC cell which 2 bits are stored per cell, so I have these states very close to each other, and I can only program and erase it in this case 10k times. And again, this degrades as I keep on scaling my cell. So if I have if I go to a 30 nanometer technology, that leaves me only with even fewer electrons, and then I can program and erase this cell only 5k times. And if I go to a 20 nanometer technology, this number is 3k times. And if I have, even if I store 3 bits per cell, or if I have that means 2 to power 3 or 8 levels in my cell, I can only program and erase it over 2500 times, and less than 1000 times if I go to a 20 nanometer technology. So this is one of the main bottlenecks, or one of the main trade-offs, that if you have a multi-level cell, if you can see over here that if you go from a single level cell, you could program it 100k times, versus if you go to a 50 nanometer MLC cell, you can program it only 10k times. And if you scale your scale, if it's a 20 nanometer technology, you can program and erase it only 3000 times. And to mitigate the impact of this, what you do is you increase the number of error correction codes. So you store these extra bits which correct for the state of the cell in case something goes wrong, and you really didn't want to lose that data. So you introduce this ECC or error correction bits, and these the number of bits that you have to introduce, which is essentially a penalty on your overall chip performance, that keeps on increasing. So your ECC requirement, it again keeps on increasing if you store multiple bits per cell as well. So there are other trade-offs as well. So if you store multiple of these levels in one cell, you have to read, or you have to essentially distinguish between this multiple of these levels. So you're even to read one of these cells, you essentially need to distinguish. Earlier you just had to distinguish between 2 levels, now you have to distinguish between 4 or 8 levels. So if you're doing a random read, your controller, it takes it some time to figure out which state your cell was. So your if you're doing a random read, your read time increases as well. So to summarize, to compare my MLC versus my single level cell technology, my MLC certainly has the advantage that it's very economically viable cell. It can let me store twice or thrice or 4 times the data in the same chip. But on the other hand, it comes with these trade-offs that my number number of cycles that I can program or erase. It degrades from, you know, 100K to, as we saw, less than 10K for, you know, 2 bits per cell, and, you know, even less than 100 or less than 1K for a triple level cell. At the same time, it's slower to read, so that's another trade-off. So in and all, it's a mixed bag of results. You do gain in capacity, but it comes with the MLC technology comes with these trade-offs.